Good evening, everyone. Baruch Hashem, we continuing our series, The Psychology of the Brain and the Soul. Today it's number 11. We're getting towards the end, maybe two to three more lectures and we'll finish it, Bezrat Hashem. If you remember, last week we finished the lecture about the age that people can start tolerate criticism. It's very hard for people to accept criticism, and we explain that between 16 to 18, that's the age when a person begin to actually accept criticism and to criticize himself. Meaning that before that, any kind of musar that you're going to give him and speak to him, he will look at that as you against him. They hate me, like the children think when the parents give them a punishment. And then if they go to the psychologist in school, why do you think your parents gave you a punishment? The answer would be, because they hate me. They hate me, they hate me. But once they become 16, 17, 18 and up, then they begin to understand that people actually care about them and they really want them to change for the better. Okay, so that's where we end last week. And Bezrat Hashem, we will continue. Rav Cheskel Avramsky, one of the biggest rabbis that we had in the last 100 years, once he was old, he lived in Eretz Israel in Beit Vagan neighborhood in Yerushalayim. A very good neighborhood in Yerushalayim called Beit Vagan. And he used to go from Beit Vagan in Yerushalayim every day to Bnei Brak, to Yeshivat Slovotka, to teach there. Right, there used to be a time that they took him with a car, you know, from the yeshiva all the way to Rothschild Street in Tel Aviv. Over there he would get a special service, rides. They have rides over there, you know, many people gather into a bus and they come to Jerusalem. So they used to give him a ride to Tel Aviv, to a place where the bus is, and he used to take it. So one time I walked on the street with Rav Schwartzman in Rothschild Avenue. And then we see from far away Rav Avramsky come down from a car and walk towards the bus stop. Let's go and talk to him, Rav Dov said. It's another big rabbi. Rav Shlomo said, he looks to me either tired or sick. Maybe we should not disturb him. Rav Dov said, we cannot leave him alone here. Let's go talk to him. And he said, if you want, you go by yourself, Rav Shlomo said. I'm not going. He went to Rav Avramsky. Rav Avramsky told him, I see Hoffman over there. Hoffman is the rabbi that we base this series on his knowledge in psychology. Call him. Tell him to join us. Right away, I ran quickly, of course. And I told Rav Avramsky, I thought the rabbi doesn't feel good. That's why I did not want to disturb him. He said, no, no, Baruch Hashem, I feel good. But the truth is that something that bothers my mind. When I left the room, in my room in Yeshiva Slovotka, I saw the Mashgiach, the supervisor, Rav Moshe Tikutsinsky, run with the pot in his hand. I asked him, Rav Moshe, where are you running with these pots? He told me, there is a guy sick in Yeshiva. I run to give him hot food. So Rav Avramsky said, Rav Moshe, why you need to run with those pots? There's no other guy in Yeshiva that can do it, that the rabbi, the big rabbi, has to do it. Rav Moshe says, in Shulchan Aruch, it says that mitzvat bikur cholim, visiting the sick, you have to do with your body. Not just send flowers or call and say, oh, how are you? I hope you're better. Or just to pray for him. That's all important, of course. But you have to make efforts with your body. So I'm doing it with my body. Rav Avramsky started to cry in the middle of the street in Tel Aviv. He said, there is a rule in Shulchan Aruch, you know, and I did not know it. Rav Moshe has to teach me how to do Bikur Cholim. He said, no, no, of course I knew it. There's not one provision in Shulchan Aruch I don't know by heart. All their life these people learn nonstop. It's my ego. It's my ego that doesn't let me run and visit a simple student. Rakam with the ball, I'm a big shot, I'm a big rabbi. That's really what it is. It's not that I don't know that. Of course I know it's mitzvah to do it with the body. But this is the kind of people we had. They always analyze what they do, every little thing. Right away, if they did something wrong, they right away started to investigate the root of the problem. It's my pride. It does not let me do it. And Rav Moshe is so humble. He does it so simply. No problem whatsoever. He doesn't hold of himself anything. Rav Shlomo says, this story caught me real good. How the biggest giants in the world lived every hour of their life with personal criticism for everything they do. He could have made excuses. I'm a very big Talmid Chacham. It's not an honor for me to be a waiter, with all due respect to the student. It's not respect for the Torah. It's disrespecting the Torah if somebody big shot like me would come with a bowl of meatballs or spaghetti or who knows what and deliver it to the room of the student in a yeshiva that he doesn't feel good today. People would say, it's nothing important. If he's like this, like a waiter, it's probably not a big rabbi, right? But he was very sad, started to cry. He said, my pride does not let me see the truth, which I should have known to do it. But you see, this is the kind of perfect people that we had in our nation, and slowly, slowly we're losing them. It belongs to the previous generation. We still have, Baruch Hashem, few, but they're very old. If you remember, in one of my lectures, I said that all the big giants rabbis that are left in the world, they're all in their 90s or past 100. Do you know what it means, right? Now we are mamash very, very close to the days that the Gemara spoke about, that en Mashiach ba, eila bedor sheichlu mimenu hachachamim. That one of the conditions for Mashiach to arrive, that the big chachamim, what the Gemara call chachamim, is disappearing from the generation. People like Rav Chaim Kanievsky sheichye, and Rav Steineman, either in their 90s or in the 100s, Rav Karelitz, Rav Sternbuch, you know, and slowly, slowly, we lost many giants. Rav Ovadia, Rav Eliashiv, Rav Vosner, one after the other leaving us. We have few more left, that's it. After those few will go to heaven, after 120 Bezrat Hashem, the generation become totally orphan. And today, since the world has changed in such a way, it will be very, very, very difficult if it's possible, to have again giant chachamim like this kind of people. Very, very difficult. If it would happen, it would be a total miracle. Why? The world is different. It's politics, all kinds of things. What's in it for me? Business, money, internet, newspapers, articles, lots of baloney around that they didn't have in their life. There was nothing. There was a table, there was a chair, a bed, and lots of books. And that's what their life was. Nobody had phone. Nobody knew what a phone, computers, none of these things that we had that destroyed the world totally, completely. Destroyed the youth, destroyed the world, destroyed the life of the family, destroyed the shuls, destroyed everything. And destroyed the rabbis. We have to be honest. Destroyed many of the rabbis as well. These kind of people, we probably won't have. We can only sit and cry for a generation that disappear in front of our eyes. There are many, you know, there used to be many, and now there's only few. Can count on one hand how many are left. And that's it. And we'll see. Bezrat Hashem, hopefully, it will be like the words of the Gemara, that once it happens, then Hashem has no choice. He has to bring Mashiach, because who's going to tell the generation what to do anymore? You know, you need them. You need them. The world needs them. The Jewish nation needs them. Without those leaders, there's nothing we can do. There used to be a very, very big, big, important chacham, the Rebbe, the Saba Mislovotka. It was a very big, older Rav from Slovotka. Slovotka was a very important yeshiva in Europe. And he was an expert in education and in chinuch. in raising Talmidim. He was one of the best one in his field. One of the greatest rabbi in the world once told me, in a moment of, you know, when you're in a mood to actually open your cards and speak free, that he was born full of ego when he was a kid. So don't look at me like I am today. When I was a kid, my ego was all the way up in the sky. But thanks to the Saba Mislovotka, I got saved from myself, from my evil inclination. Because when I was young, when I used to go to the Slovotka Rebbe, he said that when he was young, he used to use his pride to actually motivate him to be a big rabbi. Because sometimes people want to learn all their life when they're young for only one reason. Why? I also want to be a giant rabbi that everyone bow down to and kiss my hand, and I control the whole world and everything goes on my decision. And you know, it's a great honor. I don't want to be a nobody, a loser. That motivates a lot of the kids. It's of course very negative that's what motivates you. But sometimes down the road, when the people mature, they come to the conclusion that nothing good will come out of this ego. And slowly they leave it alone. And they even get disgusted from it, to the point when they see other people with pride, they want to vomit. Now two things can happen. One thing that can happen is that once you get disgusted from pride and ego, and you don't want to do it for honor anymore, you may not do it at all. You drop the learning. As long as you want it to be a big shot, one day I'll be a big Rosh Yeshiva, I walk with a special coat with two buttons in the back, like a frock, and a special hat, and always going to be a few students holding my hands, and all this show off. Once you had that dream, it gave you motivation to learn. Another year, and I'm going to be. Once you lost the desire to be this great special chacham, because ego doesn't talk to you anymore, and you finally realize it's all an illusion, then what's going to motivate you? That's a very big dilemma here. Maybe nothing. Now, what happens when a person has no motivation to learn? Check a month or two what he becomes. That's it. He goes down there. And when a person stops learning Torah, the drop in his spiritual level is tremendous. You cannot recognize him after 2-3 months. Someone was learning, and left the yeshiva, check him 2-3 months if he's still religious. If he's still religious, you'll be very surprised. You have the right to be. Why? Going back to the street, going to Manhattan, going to, you know, King's Highway, Main Street, all these places where people walk, with the way they dress, by the way they behave. Terrible. It's affecting you. What do you think? You're in a shelter, in yeshiva, learning from morning to night, only Torah. Your soul gets purified very much. Then from the holiest place on earth to the dirtiest place on earth, across the street, from the yeshiva to the street, go to Manhattan. It's a perfect example. Rav Moshe Feinstein Zatzal, he had his yeshiva in Lower East Side in East Broadway, Manhattan, Chinatown. One block from Chinatown, all Chinese idol worshippers around him, million of them, everywhere, eating cats there, across the street, eating cats and rats. And I don't have to tell you how people dress in Manhattan in the summer. And in the island of Sodom and Gomorrah, one holy building with big chachamim, one by one, giant talmidei chachamim. And Rav Moshe Feinstein on top of everyone. Imagine you come from here and stay across the street or in the middle of the street. Just stand there an hour or two, see what happened. This is it. This is the world. So sometimes they'll find other things that motivates them. They recognize the truth. They understand it's very important. They do it for the sake of heaven, not for the sake of their ego. So it's the Saba Mislovotka used to use his own ego to motivate him to be a matmid, What does it mean, matmid? Someone that is giving his life for learning, meaning that's it, I don't waste a minute. Just learning and learning and learning as much as I can, at night, day, middle of the night, all the time. The Saba used to say, someone like you supposed to know the entire Shas by heart. Meaning a genius like you, he knows he has ego, so he feed his ego to give him motivation and direction what he should do. He said to him, someone with a brain like you, the gift from Hashem, with such memory, such an amazing brain, you should have known already the entire Talmud by heart. What happened to you if you're full of pride and ego, and the most important rabbi perhaps in the world is talking to you like this? Imagine you walk to the room of Rav Ovadia Yosef with the Gemara, ask him a question, and he say to you, I don't understand. Someone with talents like you, with such a brain like you, you should have been minimum like me or more. Imagine what happened to the student when he hears such a compliment. Unbelievable. He would become like a fire for years, just from that word of a big chacham. Wamarli said to me, because he knew that I have pride, and he knew that that's what's going to trigger my learning, so he knew how to use my negative thing to actually help me to become a learner. You understand? And without these words of the Saba Mislovotka, I would never ever sit and learn the way I learned and the way I became. And of course, later on, what happened later on? You learn. Like I said, at one point you're supposed to discover the terrible habits of having high ego. Terrible. לימים הוא נתפרסם כאחד מגדולי הדור. Eventually everybody realizes he's one of the biggest rabbis in the world. Why? Because of the words of the Saba Mislovotka that motivated this gadol. They didn't mention his name here, but it's probably someone we all know. Said, the reason I am who I am is because he knew to take my negative traits and turn it to be used in a positive way. You understand? I give you an example. If you have a kid, and the kid loves when you give him compliments, he loves it. So, if you want him to do something positive, the way to do it is that you first make him do it, and then when he does it, you give him so much compliments in front of the guest. What a great son. You should see how he helps me. Everything I asked him, he did. The other day I asked him this, he did and did. And everybody said to him, great, great, Yishar Koach, Shkoyach, Shkoyach, Chazak Ubaruch. It feeds his ego so great that next time you don't have to tell him. He will look for the opportunity. Now you may come and say, but who say that it's good? If he does it for the ego, it's mitzvah ba be'avera, and a mitzvah. Mitzvah that comes through a sin. It's not a mitzvah, you're right. It's a very good, very big, very good point. But do you think it's going to remain forever, the ego? Eventually he grew out of it. Now he's a young kid. One day he will understand life and he will know how much Hashem hates proud people. Literally hates. And he won't want to be in a list of the people that Hashem hates, because a normal person, even if he's not so religious, he doesn't want to be in a black list of Hashem, if he's normal. If it's not normal, everything is possible. If he has a brain, who wants to be in a negative list of Hashem? Right? I'll give you an example. If you take an atheist to a place that you have to vote, you have two options. Behind the curtain, it's either yes or no. Yeah. And the question is, this computer screen, like the election. The thing is, would you like to be in a black list of God the day you die? And now this is an atheist. Or he has a page in Facebook, he brags how much he hates religious people, and how much he's disrespect rabbis, and how the religious people are dumb, and they're all fools, and they believe in such a thing, God. He built a career based on that, like some Israelis and Americans did. Now he's alone. If he would be in front of his friends, of course he would say yes. I would want to be in a black list of Hashem. To brag. You see? When I tell you I don't believe in God, I mean it. But now when he's going to be there alone, no one, no cameras, no nothing, do you think he's going to hit yes or he's going to hit no? Just in case. What do you think? What would you do?
No.
Everyone will hit no. If he will hit yes, then he's a real total fool who probably is patur mi mitzvot. Like they say in America, a moron. There's no brain. Why? Someone with brain will take a risk. What did you gain? Hit no, just for the 1,000% chance that there is. Why taking a risk? But I'll tell you something. Now when I'm actually saying it, maybe I regret. Maybe people have such high ego, even they want to make a show off against themselves. It's also possible. I've seen people like this, that they actually try to impress themselves. I'm not going to surrender, even when I'm here alone. You understand? I don't know where it comes from, but it's possible. Very unlikely, but possible. Rav Meir Chadash. Now we're moving to a sensitive issue. What's a sensitive issue? A beard. Long, nice beard. It's a debate among religious people if you need beard or not. It all depends who you ask. If you ask a Hasidim, all Hasidim, especially Chabad, but all Hasidim as well, the beard is one of the most important things. It should have been the first commandment and the 10 commandments. If you don't have a beard, they won't ever take you serious. Very rarely that you find one of them would even treat you like you're somebody high. It's just the look. You don't have a long beard, shagets. Nothing really to waste time on this guy. But if you ask other people, like the Litvish people, many of them learn in yeshivot for many years, some of them big rabbis, they don't have beards. Or they have short beards. They don't pay attention to beards as much. Why? The root of this issue comes from Kabbalah. In the Pshat, meaning the simple understanding of the Torah, there's no obligation to have a long beard. There's an obligation not to cut the beard with a razor. In 5 points. The 2 sideburns, the 2 end of the jaws, and the middle, under the chin. 5 places that razor should not cut the roots of the hair. Anywhere else, even here on the cheeks or the neck, even with the razor, it's permitted. But since it's too close to the dangerous areas, better to use haircut machine that it's not lift and cut. Lift and cut technology, pull the root out, and then cut the razor, cut it, then it's not good, it's like razor. Any machine that is not lift and cut is supposed to be kosher. Every machine that is lift and cut technology is like a razor. That's it. So now, the Torah said that you're not allowed to cut the roots of the hair with a razor, with metal, meaning with cream, hair remover, or with haircut machine, trimmer, or kosher shaving machine. There's no problem at all, halacha-wise. You're not making any sin. But when you begin to learn the Zohar, the Kabbalah, and the words of the Kabbalist, all of them throughout the hundreds of years, they all speak highly about the importance of having long beards because it opens up the roots of the brain, the wisdom, the roots of the wisdom. And meaning, it's besides the fact that they call it Hadrat Panim, it makes your face look more respectable. It's also opening the wisdom roots inside the brain of a person. But to come and say that someone that doesn't have a long beard is a sinner, absolutely it's incorrect because it's not against any rules in the Torah. So far I just gave you this introduction because I'm going to talk about something that happened here which you understand how you look at life correctly. Many years after my wedding, I used to shave my beard. Rav Shlomo Hoffman. I used to shave my beard. One time, I decided that I'm growing a beard. After years I got married, I came to visit Rav Meir Chadash Zatzal. He was also one of the biggest rabbis in the world. Rav Meir say, "Who are you?" I say, "Shlomo Hoffman." He say, "Who?" I don't know you. Sir Rabbi, it's me. What do you mean you don't know me? What happened? You, Chas v'shalom, you lost your memory? What's this? I said, I didn't recognize you with this beard. You started to grow a beard? Why? Now this is a very big rabbi. He's supposed to say, finally, no, today. That's what you expect. Finally you became a real tzaddik. He said to him, why did you grow a beard? Why you grew a beard? He said to him, all kinds of explanation. My wife is okay with that now. I already married. I'm becoming more knowledgeable in Torah. It's more respectful. Each one of those excuses that I gave him, he put in the garbage. Disagreed. In the end, I told him, to be honest with you, it's also convenient. I'm tired of all this shaving. That's it, I don't have to worry about it. He said, that's the first claim I heard tonight. Finally. One thing that I understand. Everything else you say to me, nothing. So you say that it's because of laziness. You're lazy. Lazy person. That's why you don't shave. He said, מי אמר שמותר לך לגדל זקן אם זה בגדל עצלות? So you're not the only lazy person in the world. Who told you that because you are lazy, you're allowed to grow a beard? Who told you to justify it? Many people are lazy, but we know our red lines. I'll be busy with this, but I won't be busy with that. Right? In their business. They're lazy? No. They get up in the morning and open the store. Right? They want money. So they overcome their laziness. Who told you that you can actually do it because of your laziness to grow a beard? It's better that you continue to trim your beard. Shave. Look how he taught me to investigate my own actions. What motivates you? What's behind it? Kosher reason or non-kosher reason? Kosher or non-kosher? Do you really do it to make Hashem happy? Do you really do it because it opens the wisdom of the brain, or you do it for the show off? I'm an important chacham. Look, black hat, beard. Some guys, they become religious 2-3 months. They already come to the yeshiva, beard and a black hat already. Making faces like this when they pray. 2 months, religious. 3 months ago, they were naked on a beach in Tel Aviv. All of a sudden, became the Lubavitch Rebbe in 2 months. He took the Lubavitch Rebbe 90 years. To him, he took 2 months. Or to all the other chachamim. Why it happens? All external. It's all a show off. Most of the time, I'm telling you from experience, it's all a show off. What people think about me, how they will evaluate me, how serious they'll take me. It's nothing l'shem shamayim. Very rarely it's l'shem shamayim. Very rarely. Most of the time, if I want to be considered someone serious, that's how I have to look. If I want my children to be in a good yeshiva, that's how I have to put this custom on Purim. תראה איך הוא לימד אותי לחקור על המעשים שלי. Look how he taught me to investigate my actions. What drives me to do things, to check if it comes from a good source or from a bad source. Everything you want to do, you have to do from recognizing and understanding what triggered that and what drives you to do it every day. I'll give you an example. Is it possible that a woman will do sheva brachos to a chatan and kala? Someone they know, either she knows the kala or the chatan, from the community, whatever, neighborhood. She's going to do a very nice, fancy, expensive sheva brachot to 30 people, maybe more. You know, it's expensive, meat, chicken, all kinds of food, fruits. Can come to $2,000 a dinner like that. Or more even. Today's prices, everything is possible. And she will do it, and of course it's volunteering, it's a gift for the chatan and kala. And she cooked for a week, she made all her salad, Moroccan this, Bukharian this, Persian this, you know, variety. And after a week of efforts and sweating in the heat of August in her kitchen, preparing and setting up the table and staying two more hours to wash dishes after, because the amiga didn't show up. And after all of that, she will get one thing. What is it? A punishment from Hashem. No reward whatsoever, just punishment. Is it possible or no? What do you think? Why? Hashem knows what motivates her. What triggered her to offer to do Sheva Brachot? Recently she moved into a new house. She wants everyone to see what a beautiful house. She's looking for an occasion. She wants to take their eyes out. Her sister-in-law, her other sister-in-law, this one, that enemy, the woman from the gym, the mother of the Chatan, which she cannot stand. The only thing that she did all of that is to kill other people, burn their hearts and their eyes. Of course, it's all a sin. Sometimes she's not that evil. She only wants people to give her great compliments about her delicious cooking. Women need it. Without it, it's very hard for them. It's perfectly normal. But even by that, there has to be a red line. A woman would like people to acknowledge her effort. She works very hard, so it's very good for her to hear, especially from her husband and even for others. Amazing, delicious, wow, how did you have time to make all of that? He really put a lot of effort, yishar koach, chazak ubaruch, brucha, kol hakavod, we appreciate you. No, fine. But to live for it, it's all the reason she does it, just for that. It turns a mitzvah into a sin. Mitzvah haba ba'avera ena mitzvah. So here you go. Sometimes a person does something big, only for one reason, show off, ego, money. It's very common. Many people are tzaddikim for the benefits they will get later on from the mitzvah they do today. The benefits. You understand? It could be many other things that motivates them. Hidden things that sometimes it takes weeks and months to discover. Weeks and months to discover. You can go to your mechanic in a neighborhood and now today's in a good mood. Say, oh, this is on the house. And so, oh, what happened to this guy? Usually it's, you know, very, very precise when it comes to the pennies. What happened all of a sudden? Here he threw in 30, 40 bucks. That's on the house. Oil change is on me today. If you're clever, your sensors begin to work. And then a week or two later, when you get a call from him, can you come speak in my father's yahrzeit? Now, ech they say in Israel, Nafali Asimon. You know what it means, Nafali Asimon? It's a slang expression. In Israel, they used to have tokens with hole in the middle, in the public phones. Special, many, many years ago, at least 30 years ago. Then they came with telecard, and today, you know. So the people used to put a simonim. You buy them in a post office with a hole in the middle, special small thick coins, silver coins, and you throw them in. So sometimes this asimon in Israel, you know, it was a primitive system, did not go in. Got stuck in the middle, you had to bang on the phone, boom, boom, until it goes in and gives you a line. So they made a joke in Israel. When finally I got them and what you say, sometimes you explain and I don't understand. You explain again. Oh, finally I got it. That means finally the token fell. It finally happened. So you understand a week later. Oh, now I understand why it was extra nice that day. Why I understand why he moved the chair for me to sit. Or he gave me a seat. Many of those things are not mitzvot. It's all interest. What's my interest in it? What's in it for me? What will I gain in a month from now? That's how it goes. So, when you do something, investigate. I gave you last week, if you remember, the example of Rav Steinman that was on a plane of Rav Shimon Glick, the philanthropist. He lives in Muncie. He has a private jet that came from Canada to New York, and they passed by the Niagara Falls. And he said to the pilot, go down, make a circle around the Niagara Falls, you'll be very, very low.
I want Rav Steinemann, the Gdol Hador, is 105 years old, bli ayin hara. I want him to see the Niagara Falls. Where else would he have chance? He lives in Bnei Brak. Now he can see it from close, from 100 yards. So the plane went, made a circle. He said, Rabbi, he was sitting on the other side of the Niagara Falls, the other window. Rabbi, come, see Niflaot Hashem, the wonders of Hashem. Unbelievable place, one of the most amazing thing Hashem created in this earth. The rabbi got up, he made 2-3 steps, and he stood. So Rabbi, come. He turned around and he went and sat down. He didn't go to watch. So Rabbi, what happened? He said, when I got up, I got very excited. I wanted to see. Then I was thinking to myself, why did I get up and run to see? Is it really because I'm impressed by Hashem's creation and I want to see his wonders, or it's out of curiosity? If it's because of Hashem, it's mitzvah. Curiosity, it's not, it's no mitzvah. And when I analyze my reasons, I realize that I got up because of curiosity, not because for Hashem. I better not see it. Curiosity is atzata yetzer hara, the advice of the devil. He went down and he sat down. Why? Control my desires. Control it. I'm in control. I did something not right. Not right. In our lifestyle, it sounds like a joke almost. This is a big curiosity. That's a sin. Rabbi, come on. Give us a chance. Give us a break, like they say in America. If this is a sin, what are we going to do? It destroy us now. If this is a sin, you set up a different guideline here. But in these standards, someone in such level, yes. So, another story, Rav Shach. Rav Shach was the head of the religious world. He sent to me a guy, 26 years old, that have difficulties in getting a shidduch. He's not getting married. 26. Ask me, help him. The guy was very shy. Very shy. His mother asked Rav Shach, help me get my son married. Rabbi, I need your help. Rav Shach called the guy and invited him to come to him. For 6 months, I met the guy every week to help him out. At that time, I met Rav Shach a few times and explained to him about that this guy is extremely shy and he has like blocks that are blocking him from going forward with, you know, creating communication with any female. How is it developing, he asked. There's any progress? How can we help other guys that have this problem? I said to Rav Shach, the big rabbis in yeshivot that teach Gemara, they invest a lot of time with the guys that has a lot of noise and energy. They're very, you know, popular, the popular guys. They make a lot of noise, they, you know, showing up everywhere, the talent. They talk to them a lot with learning, they help them a lot. But the quiet guys that barely talks and they hide in a corner, they don't have the energy or the will to run and help these kind of guys. They barely talk, it's so much work. Let me connect to the talented guy. I set him up a little bit on the right track, nice and easy. The Ramim do not pay attention to those who are quiet and hidden on a corner. It's a shame. They need the special treatment from the rabbis, not the talented, charismatic one. Then with or without the rabbis, they find the right way eventually. Those ones, if you don't give them the attention when they grow up, when they're young, they stay miserable for the rest of their life. Rav Shach say, any progress with this guy? Rav Shlomo answer, it's very hard. I don't know what's going to happen. Rav Shach, why? Rav Shlomo answer, a few weeks ago, I explained to you, Rabbi, how these things happen to children. Why they have these blocks in their life. It starts from a very young age. If we would pay attention to the problems when they was when they were very young, in the beginning, age 8, 9, 10, 12, those ages, when it begins, when you begin to see something off track, then it will be very easy to release them from this phenomena. But in age 26, it's very difficult. It's like it's a tree, it's not a plant. It's already a tree, you cannot maneuver it. It's not flexible. Since it's a habit of many years, it's very difficult to release him from it. What do we learn from here now? That the most important years in our children's life that will determine everything in their life is from the minute they were born or a few months old until they get to their bar mitzvah or bat mitzvah. These are the most critical years. If you build their confidence correctly, you work on the traits, you actually compliment them on the good things they do. When you criticize them, you do it correctly. You don't bring them down with bad words and curses and anger and all kinds of violence. That you give example of someone, an adult, a righteous person does this and this and that. Bezrat Hashem, one day you also do that and that. You understand? Not in a negative way. You're a loser. You're a bum. You're useless. Well, how did Hashem give me such a kid? Why did I do to deserve such a thing? All kinds of words that parents say to their children and murder them every day. Then they wonder why they die from heroin when they come to their teenage age. You know how many people are dying from heroin now in the communities here? Here in the communities here. A pregnant woman died from heroin, overdose. Yeah, apparently her and her husband are users. And there's many other kids here. It's becoming worse and it's a national epidemic, not only here, everywhere. I don't know what to do. The government breaking their head. Obama, the genius, had a solution. Let's not be strict on drugs violators, offenders. Get them out of jail. Yeah, that they'll be on the street and rob everyone and murder them for $60 that they need to buy the drugs. Why? It's costing us too much money. Instead of addressing the problem in the root of it, when it starts in a very young age and it becomes into a national disaster, let's ignore the problem and remove responsibility for that. Leave them bums on the street. According to Obama, in the next 10, 20 years, if he was in charge, there will be a million drug addicts, homeless people with no teeth, sleeping in bus stops, in your neighborhood, in the stairs, when you walk into the building, one here, one there, one in the laundry room, one in your car. That's good, no problem. Why? We have no room in jail. So how do you solve this? Listen, it's a big problem. It's very hard to resolve this issue. Very hard. No one denies it. It's a very, very big problem. Most likely, we would lose the war. Most likely, unfortunately. It's hard to be optimistic. But if there is a chance, it's basically, we need the mercy of Hashem. In my opinion, the only way to save this problem is if they invent something that will eliminate the effect of those drugs. Something to inject to the body, the drugs won't do anything anymore. No, and they will force those people to receive those shots, or pills, whatever it is, by force. Like this, they cannot touch drugs, no needles, no nothing. Why? It doesn't do anything to me. What's the point of injecting, costing money, and it doesn't do anything? No high, no high, nothing, none of this high illusion. That's the only solution in my opinion. If you want me to try to be optimistic, I once saw a film. The film was so shocking, I was in shock for days. And someone like me that basically saw everything you can imagine, 23 years dealing with the public, I'm telling you, it was shocking, shocking beyond words. Showed the life of the heroin addicts in Minnesota, in cold areas, places in the winter, how they freeze on the street, they look like skeleton, how they stand by gas station collecting quarter by quarter to run quickly to inject, to get to the point that they have no needles to inject anymore and they inject inside their eyes. When I saw that, I almost fainted. I couldn't function anymore. I say to myself, I wish they would show this film in every elementary school, in seventh, eighth grade, constantly, every month. The whole school come into the class. If you ever consider to touch it, look what's gonna be your end. I have no doubt that it will eliminate the majority of the problem, not everything. Because some people, even when you scare them and fear and that, nothing works. They on purpose go to do it. Like committing suicide. Okay, I'm aware of it. But to some normal kids that are said here and there, they wouldn't try. They don't want to end like that. There's a limit to how much I'm willing to pay for my bad habits. Everybody knows it, right? So Rav Shach said, how is the progress? And he told him, listen, Rabbi, he's 26. Well, you should have sent it to me when he was 11, 12. Meaning, if you have kids like that, that have communication issues, don't ignore it. They have speech problems, don't ignore it. They stutter, don't ignore it. Even if they need braces, don't be cheap. Pay a few $1,000 to make it for them. Because if they lose their confidence over that, the price that you're going to pay later on in their life will be a lot more. A lot more. You have no idea what things can make people lose their entire self-image and confidence in life. It develops serious psychological problems. Serious. Acne. Some kids, boys and girls, they have all kinds of problems in their skin. If you don't treat it carefully with specialists, with the right medication. Listen, I'm not a doctor, but I know there are ways to treat these things. You ignore it, you say, it's going to go one day. Yeah, it may go when he's 20 or she's 20. But what about 4 years that they lost totally their self-image and now they have to overcome thinking I'm the loser of the neighborhood? All my girlfriends are pretty and I'm the only monster. That's how she thinks. Now when she became beautiful, 20, no more acne, no more problem. No, she looks great. That's it. It's a problem, mental problem already. Go and try to fix it. That's problems. You know, in America, they said that the percentage of depressed people is the highest it's ever been in a history. They just came up with the statistic a week ago. The world, not only in America. The world has more depressed people now than ever in a history. They record all people who get treatment for depression. No one ever got treatment like they did last year, this past year. Every year they check. And I promise you that the numbers are at least 10 times higher than what they say. How many people b'chlal go to psychologists? 1 out of 100? 2 out of 100? 5 out of 100? When you tell your kid he needs a shrink, what does he say? Leave me alone. I'm good. Once, twice, three times. And you're afraid of them. Mind your own problems. Ay, ay, ay. Rav Shach, after he told him, Rabbi, you should have sent him when he was young. Now he's 26. I can't guarantee any success. Guess what happened? What would you do if you would be Rav Shach? Rav Shach started to cry hysterically. An old rabbi started to cry. He told me, I'm afraid of Gehenom. I'm afraid of Gehenom, hell. What kind of punishments I'm going to get there? What they're going to do to me every day? You're right, because you're right, I'm afraid. Those who come to us and we give them our time, they don't really need it. The ones that really need our times, they don't come to us. We let them die. And those who needs us, we don't have time for them. And now you say that even you cannot help anymore because we neglected them for so many years. I heard from Rav Meir Kessler, Shlita, that a while after that story, all the rabbis that used to go to the house of Rav Shach for meetings, big Rashi Yeshivot, heads of yeshivas, he would tell them after that case of this boy with 26 years old, everyone who come, please, I'm begging you, take care of the quiet kids in your yeshiva. Give them love, attention, talk to them, invite them. Don't focus on the charismatic smart ones. They already have the gift from Hashem. Work on those who don't have it. Those are the ones that has to be saved. I wish everybody would understand that in the schools, in the yeshivot. Teachers are people. They want also convenience. They don't want to work 10 times harder. It's much harder work. One loser, excuse my language, it's 10 times more work than dealing with a winner. Very simple. It's not only in school. So it's inside our houses. A few kids. Sometimes you just tell the guy, you do it. Why me all the time? Because I don't want to waste 5 minutes explaining this guy. What do you think? The other guy doesn't get the point? What do you think? Why my father always tell him, always him, always him, always him? In a business, him. In this, in a house, him. When he called from overseas, where is Itzi? Where is this? Call him, put him on the phone. I can help you. No, put him on the phone. Why? Bottom line, you loser, dumb. I don't have time for you. Put the smart one on the phone. Same thing in business. Same thing by employees. What do you think? They're not getting the point? It's a silent murder. You're murdering people without realizing. And we will be judged for it. Don't think that Hashem would let it go. Because we have to be extra sensitive for the weak. Some people in this country, they speak, why should we support the poor people with our taxes? Why do I have to pay so much taxes that all the bums on the street will be unemployed, collecting unemployment from my own money? I kill myself, I work, I went to college, I got a degree, I became a doctor, I work, I don't know, 10, 12 hours a day, and in the end I have to pay 40, 50% tax that all the bums on the street playing domino and cards, they're gonna drink cerveza on my expense? Sounds very convincing, right? In a way, they're right. They have a point. But they're also wrong. Why they're right, everybody knows. But I want any one of you to tell me why they're also wrong. Why they're wrong? I'll help you. The reason that they're wrong, in a society, you have strong and weak people, always. Every country. You have strong people, strong brain, strong strength, financially strong, strong family, strong health-wise, and then you have the weak. Weak, lack of confidence, no brain, not smart people, very lazy, depressed, don't want to do anything because they have all kinds of mental issues. That's in every country. It's always been like that. It's not only today. It's been like that 1,000 years ago and 2,000 and 3,000 and 4,000 years ago. You can see evidence to it in the Torah and in the Gemara, that that's how every world, every country was. So what do? You must support the poor and the weak and the sick and the old people. You must. Why? First, for humanic reasons, we are people, we're not monsters. And even though they don't deserve to clap for them and they don't deserve a compliment, most of them, because they don't try to help themselves. But if you neglect them, do you know what would happen? They will murder you. They'll kill you on the streets. They'll put a gun to your head. Do you think you can live in a country with 400 million people when actually 100 million of them are either unemployed or depressed or when came out of jail or they're drug users? And they live off the disability and social security and single moms that their husband left them, or you know, they never got married and all kinds of problematic youth. Do you think that if you're not gonna set up a system to take care of them, do you think you'll be safe? What's all your wealth will help you? You won't be able to do anything. You're gonna have a nice Bentley. You won't be able to drive it 2 blocks, not in Queens, not in Brooklyn, not in Bronx, nowhere. Because 1 or 2 blocks later, someone will shoot you and rob you. Why? Because you have nothing to lose. He doesn't care to sit in jail. His life is worse than jail. So don't pretend that you care about them. You gotta do it to buy yourself peace of mind and freedom. That's what it is. Let me bribe you, Mr. Loser. let me bribe you, Mr. Lazy Guy. Just leave me alone. Don't rob me and don't kill me when you see me driving my fancy car and my mansion. Don't bother. Here, I'm giving you a few $1,000 a year, food stamps. Eat and be quiet. That's what it comes down to. You gotta buy yourself freedom. Do you know one country that everyone is rich and successful and talented and smart and healthy? Where? If you know any place, let me know. So, after Rav Shach was crying, the subject continued. What does the Rav mean when he say, in 16 we were able to save him? Rav Shlomo, answer. A shy guy, that means he has a block communicating with people. He's insecure, he has his issues. You have to address this issue and release him from that blockage. Some people are very talented, but when they were young, they were abused by angry parents or in school, and they hold it in. They hold it in the heart, and they don't let go. And it builds inside, builds, and more, and more, and more. And then they have not natural blockage. Shy, fear, all kinds of things like that. And then if we address it when it begins in the first year, we can build it up. We can rebuild their confidence and cure the horrible effect of the abuse that they had. Rav Meir Chadash Zatzal would take a guy like this and talk to him in learning, in Limud. What did they learn in yeshiva? Then he would come to a group of guys and talk to them in Gemara and ask them questions. And then he would say to them, I heard from this guy a great, wonderful answer to this question. Who was this guy? The loser. The one that he has no confidence. He's hiding, he's shy, he's mute. He would come to the great guys in school and say, this guy gave me a fantastic answer. What? He knew the answer to this? He understood this Tosfot in Gemara? You sure? Yes. Why would he do it? To make him famous. It would make him feel great. Wow, we heard you gave the answer to the rabbi. Amazing. Wow, I didn't know you're so clever. We don't know he's so smart. After a few times he would do it, it built his confidence until he wants to talk now. Now he raised his hand in class. The teacher built his confidence. Look how it could be sometimes very easy. 5-6 days you invest in him, you save his life. You save his marriage, future marriage. You save his children raising. You save so many things by investing a little bit in this boy. It makes him wants to speak. Slowly, slowly, he gets released from all this blockage that he had from childhood. One time, Rav Shach saw that one of the students in his yeshiva doesn't come to learn. A few days he's laying in bed. Doesn't get up in the morning, doesn't come to pray, nothing. He asked one of his roommates, what's going on here? The rabbi is very depressed. Why? He went on a shidduch date, and it looked like he's going to close after, you know, a few times that they dated. And in the last minute, the girl changed her mind, and she doesn't want to marry him. It broke his heart. Probably in love with her already, you know, her feelings. He thought that that's it, finally I got my shidduch. And, you know, according to the expectation, that's how the disappointments are. If you date someone and you wouldn't think, ah, I don't have a chance with her. I'm gonna, for the 1% chance, I'll do it. And if she tells you after the date no, you're not so disappointed. Why? Because you already knew. The chance is 1%. But if you're confident that it's going to happen, especially when she gives you a lot of attention and she shows interest and she tells the shatran, it was amazing, I want to go again and again and again, you already feel that's it. Everything is almost 99% is set. Baruch Hashem, next month I'll be married already, finally. Then all of a sudden, explosion. It breaks your heart. That's why I always, I made a lecture about it. According to the expectation, that's how the disappointment. So what's the solution? Don't ever develop high expectation from any human being on earth. And also not from Hashem. From human being, it's obvious, it's not even in their hands if to help you or not. It's Hashem's decision. Sometimes they can promise you the world, your uncle, your father, who knows, your father-in-law, and in the end things don't work out the way they plan. With Hashem, you sometimes expect Hashem to do for you certain things that it's against your tikkun. That's not what Hashem sent you to the world. Yeah, you want it very much, but Hashem didn't send you to the world for this purpose. So you develop high expectation, and in the end it doesn't happen, and it breaks your heart. What's the solution? Do not expect from anyone nothing. He will help, fine. He won't help, no hard feelings. You don't owe me anything. I didn't expect that much anyway. Same thing with donation, same thing from your partner, same thing when you go on a project with someone, same thing in your marriage. Don't expect.
One time, I was sitting by Rav Shach, and he explained to me that there is few rabbis came to complain that they don't get paid on time. Rav Shlomo said to Rav Shach, I know that Rosh Yeshiva, he always pay on time, it cannot be. Rav Shach says, if they complain, there has to be something here. Rav Shlomo says, Rav Shach, I heard in Yerushalayim all kinds of rumors that people speak against you, Rabbi. Is it possible that people say such thing about you? Rav Shlomo, you know me. Does it look to you logical that I'm going to do such things? Of course not, Rabbi, I know. Then we continue to talk about those rabbis who complain about the paycheck. And then I repeated it again. Rabbi, I heard this and this about you. He stopped me. Shlomo, tell me, since when you believe what people speak on the street? Don't you know people, they just speak and speak? You know me, you know there's no chance I'm capable of doing things like that. Rav Shlomo answered, Rav Shach, of course it's not true. But why you just told me, Rabbi, that if those rabbis complain about the Rosh Yeshiva that he doesn't pay them on time, it has to be something. They won't blame him otherwise. Rav Shach stopped for a minute. Then he got up from his chair. He started to cry. He burst in tears. He was crying like a baby. He got up. He kissed me on my head. And he said to me, you're right. How did I make such a mistake? Thank you for showing me my mistake. This is what's happening. Just what you hear, get yourself used to never to believe what you hear. No matter how convincing it is. I can tell you from experience, over the years, people make up stories about me nonstop. Good and bad. More bad than good. Lies, stories, everyone add things to the story. People claim they used to be with me in a class. All kinds of stories like this. You have no idea how evil people can be. You know, it's enough. You can criticize about what you hear. You don't like it. No, fine. You just heard it. You can bring your arguments. But usually 99.999% of those stories are totally fake. Fake, like Donald Trump say, fake news. You know? The problem with that is that people are so naive that when they read something in the internet, immediately they believe. Somehow it's like their God. But in reality, you see that almost never it's true. Even when they say compliments, it's also not always true. They add to the stories. They add to the stories. Sometimes it's true, sometimes it's not true. I'll give you an example. I was now here in Main Street in a store. Someone saw me outside, talking on the phone. He waited a few minutes until I finished. Then he asked me, He told me, I want to tell you something. So what? So I was already mamash very close to get divorced. I left the house. And Baruch Hashem, a lecture that you made in LA a few years ago came to me. I listened to that lecture. That lecture changed my whole life. From side to side. Everything worked out. I saved my marriage. Baruch Hashem. So here is an example of what we said before. That most of the people in their marriages, they never prepared for it. They develop high expectation, and then according to the expectation, that's how they got disappointments. If a person comes ready and trained for the crisis and for what marriage is about and what you have to give, and don't expect too much to receive, then you will actually enjoy it. If you came with a wrong education to the marriage, you pay the price big time, and all the people around you suffer. So this guy told me, after I heard that lecture, it changed everything. And he said, the guy was so emotional and sincere, say, I'm your servant for life. Anything you need from me, give me his number. He said, even literally, if I have to kill for you, just let me know. Not much like that. Why is it? Because one lecture was right, the right thing in the right time for him. If he would hear it a year later, he won't help. Life would be over already in a marriage with the children. That was mamash hashgacha mishamayim that he got to his end. And that he heard and he fixed his mistakes. Most people, they can hear, they admit, and they stay the same. Unfortunately. To be able to change, you need to be a hero. Rav Isaac used to send me, in 30 years, when you compete with one of your friends from yeshiva, who is going to be the next Rosh Yeshiva, the head of this institution? How would you feel? When I was young, I never thought about things like this. But he made all kinds of exercise with me to teach me to know myself, to recognize my traits, my talents, my negative, my positive, that I should get to know myself. The problem with people, that they are sure they don't have ego, no pride, no anger, no jealousy. They walk 50 years with the feeling, I'm religious, I'm a tzaddik, I have a nice beard, I have a nice sombrero. I learned many years in yeshiva, who is better than me? That's how they think. And then when they have one major test in their life, nisayon, the yetzer, the even inclination explode, and they destroy the world. So, such a pity to see families, beautiful families, fighting for inheritance. How many families were great until the father died? That's where the problems and the real face of the children came out. As long as the father was in control of the business or the real estate, no one made a beep next to him. Who wants to mess with him and lose his share? Now when he passed, the ugliness and the bad traits and the jealousy and the anger and all the negative things you can imagine all explode in weeks or days or hours. There was one case in Israel that they fought for the father's car. They divided the real estate. They only fought for the car. Well, how much a car was? $20,000. That was the fight. He left the millions of dollars, the father. In the end, one guy said, you know, just take the car and leave me alone. Just take the car and get out of here. Take it. It's yours. He drove 100 yards, got into an accident and died. On a spot. Happened in Israel. Rav Zilberstein bring it in his book. With the case, with the, you know, when it happened. He drove less than a minute and he died. Sometimes you don't die. You fight for 20 years. You don't talk to your brothers, your sisters. You'll be surprised. You think it's only by ordinary people? No, 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 no. We always have to say the truth. We are not here to hide our problems. It happens by families of the biggest rabbis you can imagine. When they pass, you have to see how their children behave. All of a sudden, religious children that they're also rabbis. What do? They go to the Israeli court. Nobody cares anymore about Moiser. Then you're not allowed to go to a non-Jewish court, non-Orthodox court. All of a sudden, they get lawyers. All of a sudden, girls contest the will. They know it's against the Torah what they do. Religious girls all their life, from the best yeshivot for girls. Supposedly, their children are already rabbis. The Rebbe said, why? She didn't get her few hundred thousand shekel or dollars or whatever the case is. She knows that the father, he gave to the sons because the daughters married to the husband and they have money from him. He left it for his sons, like the Torah say to do. And they go to contest the will, go against their big tzaddik father, embarrass him over there in Beit Din Shel Mala, in heaven with all the tzaddikim. Look what kind of children you have. Look how they fight for money. Not that they're poor. They're already loaded as it is. But they fight with each other and it goes to the Israeli news and all the chiloni makes a party out of it. Look at this family. This is a family of a big rabbi. The biggest chilul Hashem in the history of the world, they do. Without going into names, it doesn't really matter. Just to get the concept. Do you understand? Now, where does it come from? Why things like this happen? If you would ask them 30 years earlier, when your father, the tzaddik, one day will pass, and he will decide not to share the inheritance equally, and he would leave you out, and will give you very little, how would you handle it? You ask him now, he's in yeshiva, he's 30, 40 years old, one day his father will pass when he's 90, 100, whatever. You're going to be already 70 by then, or 60. Your father would leave the world one day. You'll be already, you can be a grandfather yourself already. And you'll find out that your father decided to give all his wealth to one or two or three, for whatever reason. Maybe he decided that those are poor and the other ones are rich. Let me give all my money to the poor sons to balance the situation a little bit. That's also logical. Why not? If you have five sons, two of them are multimillionaires. They own a lot of business, real estate. And three of them working. One is a bus driver. One is working in a restaurant. They barely make a living. What would you give? You divided five equally? No. You call the two rich ones. Say, listen, you know, I love you just as much. But your other three brothers are struggling. What's the point? Let them at least get out of their misery. They have children, they have to put them in yeshivot. Or giving directly to the grandchildren. You can give it while you're alive. Or you write it in a will. How will they react? Sometimes they will eat their heart. They will hate their father forever after that. But they won't dare to make chilul Hashem. They will eat their heart inside. They will smile fake smiles to the other brothers. And pretend everything is okay. No, I respect it, no problem. But they will hate them, and they will hate the father, and they will hate everyone. But they won't dare to go to the news or to the court. Sometimes they have such ugly character, they will go to court, they will contest, they will spread Lashon Hara, they will tell secrets about their own brothers and sisters. You have to see how ugly it can get. If you ask him 30 years ago when he was learning from morning to night like this with his finger in yeshiva, like this, with his beard, with all the faces, what a tzaddik. Tell me, in 20 years, do you think you will take your brothers and sister to court for a few hundred thousand dollars or for $50,000? Court? By the chilonim? You crazy? You lose your olam haba. You're not allowed to take Jew to a secular court or to a goyish court. That's what you think of me? Shame of you! I'm a Rosh Yeshiva! I'm writing books! I have a shamash hold my hands when I walk. You telling me that I'm going to take my brothers to court? For money? Well, you don't think I have emunah in Hashem? And when 20 years later it would happen, you will find that he's the biggest monster on earth. So how does it work together? Very simple. By me? Never. For many years, when we learned together, a group of guys by Rav Shlomo, He used to make all kinds of exercise for us. For instance, he would ask, if you get a job to become a Rosh Yeshiva for $500 a month, or to be a manager in a store for $5,000 a month, manager in a restaurant, in a plumbing supply, $5,000 a month. In Israel, it's a big money. In Israel, it's a big salary. And, or $500 in yeshiva, barely make a living, the yeshiva. They'll pay you $500 to be in charge. Would you take the manager for $5,000 or the mashgiach in yeshiva for $500? Or Rosh Yeshiva? What would you prefer? He made us all these exercises to see how we begin to analyze ourselves. What really I would do? I would leave the Torah for $5,000 a month, or I would stick to the Torah no matter what happened. A person learns to know himself and what drives him, what's its temptation for him and what's not, what gives him satisfaction more than what? Money, honor, effort, rest, the good life. Everyone runs after something. One person will take a job for honor, even if he won't make a salary. I am the president of the United States, free, $1 a year. I'm the mayor of New York, $1 a year. I'm a billionaire, I have 15 billion. Why do I need a salary of the mayor of New York? I work for $1 a year. Why? Obviously, he did not take the job for money. He had plenty of money. So why do you need to leave your billion-dollar empire, $15 billion empire, to become the mayor of New York? Don't you see it's always headache, problems, a terrorist attack, FBI, corruptions, courts, problems, newspapers bashing you every day and every night? I'm the king. I'm in charge. I don't care what you do. I'm the boss. You will all bow down to me. I have a cousin. He was a very big lawyer. He owned his own firm in Israel with a partner, making fortune. Very successful criminal lawyer. Not religious. And one day, he went to be a judge. Became one of the biggest judges in a court in Israel. I asked him once, why would you give up a salary of $100,000 a month for a salary of $5,000 a month? What a judge makes. Add the car, add some other benefits he gets. Not even $10,000 a month. As a judge in a court, why would you give up 90% of your income? It's not about the money. It's about achievement. He's not going to say ego. I want to be in charge. I want to be to make it to the Supreme Court. I want to rule Israel like these liberal lefties that sits in the Supreme Court. Changing slowly, Baruch Hashem now. They put another two judges now that have a head on their shoulder. What happened in the end? There was so much competition and battling, he gave up. He went back to be a lawyer now recently. He didn't make it to the Supreme Court. Even though all the lawyers have to give a mark to the judges in court in Israel every year. They make a survey. And he got always 5 out of 5, from 1 to 5. All the lawyers gave him 5. Conducting, coming ready for the case, working serious, concentrate, sharp, behave properly. Everything he got 5. But there were a few that didn't like the fact that he's Faraday. They didn't like it. They put sticks in his wheels. What? You're going to be... That's how it is. Racism everywhere. From both sides. Most of the people, that's what everyone thinks is a god. And in the end, he went back to be a lawyer. The only difference now, from what I'm understanding now, is not as successful even half of what he used to be. Technically, you would think someone that was a big judge in a criminal court, going back to be a lawyer, people should stand online. No. But the idea that you understand what's going on here, for ego, for honor, for power, people willing to pay tons of money. You don't believe me? Do you know how many people pay reporters to make positive articles about them in the internet in Israel? You know how many times they offer me to be the PR for me? Famous reporters. You give us $6,000 a month, anything you want us to write about you in the lead newspapers in Israel, you go like this, and it's there. We make you interviews and television, this, that. I kept pushing them away, pushing them away. So what do? If you don't surrender to that, then they begin to write bad about you. They'll put pressure on you. You have to be very strong. You're almost like a mafia. You either pay us protection, and we're with you, or you don't pay us, we burn your store. That's how it goes. So one of them came to one of my lectures. We came to check out. He saw hundreds of people over there in Tel Aviv. And he was very impressed. He has a Jewish heart, after all, the tricks. So it softened him up. So he came to me and said, you know what, forget what we had until now. I'm going to give you 1 month on the house and show you how much I can make you the king of the world. And after that, you will see how much you want to pay me. Is that fair deal? He made the next morning for me an interview on the hottest show in Israel, morning news. Everyone listen, all the housewife, everyone in the morning, 7 a.m. They have the, how people start on the internet, in the cars, at work. People watch that news. I didn't even go. I was waiting by the studio. I didn't go. Someone surrender to these people. They want to control you. They want to run the world. People pay. Told me, this one paid me. This one paid me. That one paid me. People pay money to have positive articles on the news. You believe it? And sometimes people pay reporters to write negative against people they don't like. That also exists. That's why I'm telling you, don't ever believe the internet. Not the news, not what people write in a comment, not what they write in an article. Sometimes they make a lot of innocent mistakes. Even when they wrote beautiful articles about me, for instance, they made a wonderful article about me in one of the most leading religious newspapers in the world. And they wrote over there that I'm a pilot. I told him that I was in the Air Force, Israeli Air Force, in a unit of F-16. He decided to write pilot to help me out. Now go and tell the whole world you're not a pilot. You understand? Do you understand how it works or no? I'm going to say I was in the Air Force without being an Israeli pilot. It's not good for the story. Another word. It makes the story a lot better. And it did. But it's a lie. It's a lie. You don't want to build yourself with lies because it will explode in your face sooner or later. That's how Hashem made the world. All the lies will be exposed. If not here, in the next world. You rather it will be here, that you get the shame here and get rid of it. If it will explode in your face in front of Hashem, it's going to be a million times worse. You will regret the moment that they didn't expose you when you were alive. That's what people don't get. By asking all these questions, what would you like to be? Would you go after money or would you go after honor? Would you rather work very hard or would you write easy jobs? All kinds of questions like this when you ask students when they're young. Would you like to be a plumber for 5,000 shekel a month? Or would you like to be a cook in yeshiva for 500 shekel a month? At least you're busy feeding Talmidei Chachamim. What's the priorities for you? Would you prefer honor? Would you prefer food? Would you prefer an easy and clean job? Would you prefer money even if the job is very dirty and hard? All kinds of questions like this. Why it's important to ask the kids questions like this? Because they get to know themselves. When a person says to his Rebbe, I would rather be an avrech in kollel for 500 shekel and not a big shot in a company and run a company for 10 times more. Then he will ask you, why? You're going to have a family, wife, children, you can live in a comfortable home. It will go further. Maybe you change your mind. You know what? When I think about it, you're right. I don't want to live in a basement of one bedroom until I'm 35. If I have a good job, 10 years, I'm going to work hard, I'm going to buy myself a nice house. and my wife will be happy in her beautiful American kitchen. Then I'm going to have a car. I'm tired of being in the buses. He will give you enough reason to see that in the end you sold Hashem for money. At least you know who you are. Why? If you don't know who you are, you live in illusion. And then one day the illusion will explode in your face. I promise you that these people went to court to fight about their father's money. If you connect them to a lie detector 20 years ago and tell them that one day they'll do it, they would say absolutely no chance. The machine will show that they really believe it. They never had intention to do it. But once it happens, the truth comes out. Well, I'll give you an example. There was one Rosh Yeshiva who one time came to me and said to me, I'm tired of the yeshiva. That's, I cannot go on anymore. I'm here for years. I had enough. Here is the key. Here is the Pinkas check-in, the checkbook. Run the yeshiva. Go bring this rabbi. There was another big rabbi that was available. Bring him to be the Rosh Yeshiva. You'll be in charge of everything here, the money, the checks, the bills. Let me go learn. I said to him, but what about your parnasa? You have a family, you have a home, health insurance. You need at least $10,000 to survive. It was many years ago, the story, close to 20 years ago, maybe 18 years ago. 10,000, family like you need $10,000 to survive. House, health insurance, car, insurance for the car, electric bill, children in yeshivot, minimum 10,000. That's living like a beggar. He told me, I trust Hashem. How did I live until now? Thanks to the yeshiva? No, Hashem helps the yeshiva and I got a salary. Hashem will help me, I'm not worried. I said to him, okay, if that's what you want, let me go to that rabbi. I went to that rabbi, famous one. I went to him, I said to him, this is what he said. He smiled. From his smile, I already started to smell something. I'm too naive. I was young. He was already Shu'al Vatik. Very, very experienced rabbi. Back then, he was 60, maybe. He looks at me like the young, inexperienced kid who comes to me with the offer, come take over the yeshiva. I said to him, yeah, he said, he had it. I cannot take it anymore. He said to me, go back to him, tell him to announce today that he leaves the yeshiva, he quit. Thank you very much. Don't worry, a different rabbi will take over. After he took his stuff, his books, everything, and he left, the next day I'll come. Smart, he knew. I told him, Rabbi, why do we need all this? Isn't it better you come now, you shake his hand, he will show you the place, and he will tell everyone he's taking my place. He told me, no, you're young and naive. Just do it as I said. I went back to him. What do you think happened? I went back to him. I said, okay, I spoke to him and he agreed. He said that you should announce that you're leaving and tomorrow you'll come take over. You don't have to worry about money. And he also had a lot of people who sponsor and give him money. He will take care of the yeshiva, make it bigger. Nothing you should worry about. You don't even need me in the picture. I can help technically, you know, but he's a big shot enough to run this yeshiva and more. So I said to him, okay, just then. So he looks at me, like we never spoke yesterday. He looks at me, and what's going to be with me? He said to me, what's going to be with me? He said, well, I asked you that question yesterday. I asked you this. You told me I trust Hashem, this. I said, okay, well, what do I know? But Rabbi, I have children, I have this, I have that. I said, are you putting me in a bad spot now? You made me go and talk to him. He said to me, so you want me to live just like that? I said, I don't want you to live at all. You came to me for help. No, I only did what you told me. Of course, he never agreed to leave. Don't get me wrong. He's a very big tzaddik. We're not talking about one of the crooks. A very honest person, big tzaddik. You have to see how he pray. How he lives simple. I wish all the rabbis would be like him. But even someone like him, when he came to the moment of a big test, immediately he failed. He got paranoid. Do you think that the day before when he told me go get him, he wasn't sincere? I won't sign on it. Maybe if I connect him yesterday to a lie detector, he would pass the test. Maybe when he told me go and get him, he really meant it. Or maybe it was just a trick to get attention. Why? Maybe he should come and help me anyway, keeping me the boss and help me from the side. Maybe he wanted attention, I don't know. People do things for different reasons. Baruch Hashem, that was the end of the story. This is why you need, when you're young, to challenge your character. Do you think if you're going to go on with a girl, you're Baal Tshuva? Do you think if you're going to go on a date with a girl, you're going to be Shomer Negiah after a month? What? You crazy, Rabbi? What do you think about me, Ma? I'm religious. Enough, enough with the nonsense. I hear about a lot of religious people, how they behave when they date. It's only holding the hand. What are you so fanatic? Not trying to kiss you or something. Who do people come to cry to? Rabbi, I'm very sorry. I don't mean to speak Lashon Hara, but this is what happened in a date. Get the shock of your life. Huh? What? You serious? The guy is learning a few years. How can it be? It's not a chiloni from the beach in Tel Aviv. He never addresses his problems, his weakness. He was sure already, since I'm here for 3-4 years learning Gemara, I'm already Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. Remember what I said last week in a shiur? To have desires does not make you a criminal. You have desire for food, you're not a criminal. You have desire for pork, you're not a criminal. You have desire for women, you're not a criminal. You have desire to steal, you're not a criminal. You have desire to murder, you're not a criminal. You have desire to be gay, you're not a criminal. You only become a criminal if you follow your desires. That's where the Torah comes to protect you. There's ways to protect you, if you're willing to cooperate. To have bad thoughts, to have desires, to imagine I want to do this and this and that, that's perfectly normal. That's why Hashem brought you to the world, for this. This is the test in life. So if you think that because you learn in yeshiva many years that you don't have desire for women, you're a liar. If you think that you don't have desire for food that is not 100% kosher, you're also a liar. If you think you don't have desire to speak Lashon Hara, you're a liar. Everything, you're a liar. Everything. Because only very few people in the world barely have desires. And you know what? Even the biggest rabbis in the world, they admit, I did it for ego. I did it for this, I did it for laziness. Remember what I said before. The rabbi was walking to the bus stop and he saw Rav Hoffman and another rabbi, and what did he say to him? I did not go to bring food to that student, hot food, not because I didn't know the halakha that you have to visit the sick and you have to do something with your body. Because how would it make me look? Such a big chacham like me, teaching Gemara to the whole world, the greatest brain, the biggest rabbi. I became a waiter, I bring to one of my students soup to his bed. It's not kavod haTorah. It's chilul Hashem. It's disrespecting the Torah. Hundreds of excuses, which are all lies. The real reason, 1,000,000% ego. And he was already 40 years or 50 years learning Gemara. Do you understand? So who do you think you are? Let's face it. Who do you think you are? If people that are considered the greatest on earth in what they do, they tell you, I have this weakness, I have this problem, I have this, I have this weakness, I'm not good, I'm not this, I'm not 100%. Either way, it has to turn on a light, a warning light in your head. If he is not good, who am I? Remember last week I told you of Eliashiv? One guy came to him and said, Rabbi, I have debt that I owe to people. I owe money to people. Few tens of thousands of shekel. But I'm learning, I'm steiging, I'm in yeshiva, I'm growing every week. What should I do? Should I quit learning in yeshiva and go to get a job and pay my debt? Or I should continue to learn a few more years until I one day become a rabbi, then I have a job and this, and then I'll pay it later. Let them wait a few years. I'm learning after all, I'm not on a beach. So Rav Eliashiv said to him, are you able to focus in your learning? He asked him, Rav Eliashiv, 102 years old. He asked him, are you able to focus? By the way, in case you didn't know, Rav Eliashiv was the biggest of all the biggest. All the rabbis in the world, it was the highest level. And he said to him, are you able to focus on your learning? The guy said to him, yes, of course, I'm learning every day. He said to him, I don't know, I wouldn't be able to focus one day in the learning. If I owe money to people and they are upset, they're angry, that I'm not returning anything, I wouldn't be able to learn. Quit the yeshiva, go get a job, pay everything, and then go back to the yeshiva. You understand? I wouldn't be able to focus. Why are you telling stories? You don't have paranoia. You don't have anxiety attack. You don't have fear. People knock on your door. People embarrass you. People talk lashon hara about you that you're not paying back. And you're telling me that you focused on your learning? You have to be some kind of a superman. Because I, Rav Eliashiv, that learned 100 years in my life, straight, from morning to night, I wouldn't be able to focus in simple learning, which I learned 100 times the Gemara. I wouldn't be able to learn if I owe money to people. So it could be two things. One is that you're really a big rasha, that you don't care about people's feelings, you don't care about stealing, you don't care about destroying them. They can come, cry, beg you, the widow, please give us the money, or my husband, for food. And you throw her from the stairs, and you don't have a heart. You're basically a Nazi. That's one possibility. And the other one, you're better than Rav Eliashiv. One of the two. Choose which one you want to be. It's all illusions. That's what happened to a lot of religious people. I see a lot of people rising, 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 and boom, collapsing to zero and to below zero. Why? Everything was based on fake. It was all illusions. He all lied to himself. He thought it's something special. I don't know if to laugh or to cry when I hear Balei Tshuva of 2, 3, 4 years, beginners, in the beginning level, how they talk how I used to be. Do you know these ones that make interviews? When I was secular, I used to be like this, and I used to be like that, and I used to be like this. You're exactly the same. You just learn to hide it in the right places. That's all. Tomorrow somebody's gonna push on your nerves, the monster that are still inside you will explode in a minute. Same exact thing. The difference is that before you became religious, you didn't care to see a girl on the street and whistle to her and speak to her in front of everyone. Why? And make you a macho man. What a great guy. Look at him. Now you know it's a disgrace because all the religious people would want to spit to your direction. So now you convince yourself that you're not like that anymore. But who are you fooling? And again, this is the point I'm trying to make here. Don't think that if you steal like that, you're a criminal. The idea is not to do it. It takes many, many years to fix it from the root. It doesn't happen in 2, 3, 4 years. Forget about it. It may take 40, 50 years. Rav Moshe Feinstein, I spoke to his student, his name was Alex. He used to daven with me in Lower East Side in a shul. We sat together in Shabbat, in Seudah Shlishit. I told him, Alex, tell me something about Rav Moshe. You were with him every day in yeshiva. So he told me that one time he went to fill up Shana Tova cards, because he was the head of Agudat Israel, and every night, volunteer from the yeshiva used to come with the Rebbetzin and fill up. There was no email list. Remember, there was no computers back then. So he had to mail them manually. So he said, I came at 8 until 10, and I was riding, filling up, they had the list. So at 10 o'clock, Rav Moshe went to bed, put pajama. Every night, 10 o'clock, exactly, he went to bed. And he was waking up very early in the morning. Then after half an hour or so, he got up, He came out, Alex, forgive me, Alex. He's holding my hand, almost crying. What happened, Rabbi? Maybe he had a bad dream. No, 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 forgive me, forgive me. Okay, okay, I forgive you, but for what? How ungrateful I could be. You come to do my job, and I went to sleep without telling you thank you and good night. From the sleep, he woke up from his subconscious. Warning. So Alex told me, I looked at him, I was totally in shock. I asked him, Rabbi, are you a human being or are you an angel? You're not a human being. How you became like this? How you became like this? So he told him, I work very hard for many years on myself. I was totally the opposite. If you knew Rav Moshe Feinstein Zatzal, no one would ever imagine that he could be any different than what he was. He was the most humble person, nice, charming, friendly, humble. It's one in a generation or two, you find people like this. But he said to Alex, I worked on myself very hard. I wasn't born like this. It takes long, long, long time to work on yourself. It's not. If you came to the world with perfect traits, you would not come to the world. Remember this. Hashem will not bring you to the world. Mamash, before we finish, last thing for today, personal criticism. You review yourself. It was, for me, a very big chidush. Very new to me. Very new to me. What? What was new to me? It's not, as Rabbi told him, it's not any greatness to be nice to people that are nice to you. Don't hold any credit for yourself. If you're nice to friends, people who help you, people who respect you, people who speak greats about you, no. If you won't be nice to them, you're a monster. Thank you for not being a monster. But you're still not a human being yet. You have to work very hard to get to that level. If you're nice to people you don't know, who are they? I'm the head of the institution, and this kid come to me and talk to me now. I'm wasting my time on him. Yes, with respect to children, to women, to goyim, to the cleaning guy. And, needless to say, to someone who hates you and speak against you, and you're still nice to him. That's already a very, very high level. Like David HaMelech said, when Shimi ben Gera was cursing him, they were ready to kill him. What is this? Moret b'malchut, rebelling against the king? Leave him, let him curse. Hashem told him to curse. You cursing the king? Immediately execution. No one would make a peep. The king did what he must do. Execute this Rasha. Cursing the king, in front of people, Moret b'malchut, leave him. Hashem told him to curse. It's a very high level. You have the authority to retaliate, and you don't. The Prime Minister of Israel many years ago, Ariel Sharon, when the Hamas used to blow out buses in Israel every day, if you remember that period of time, every day 20 people died, 15 died, sometimes 2 or 3 in a day. They interview him and he say, sometimes not to retaliate, it's a greatness, meaning a power. We choose out of power not to retaliate. The truth was that they didn't have the power. There's nothing they could do. You can go and fight in a different country, army against army with airplanes. You cannot fight the Hamas terrorists who put bombs under their jacket and get on buses. They know they have no answer to it. Suicide bombers. There's no answer to it. If Chas v'Shalom they decide to do it here in New York, every hour they can blow up a bus or a train. What, you start checking every person who gets on a bus? Every person who gets on a bus, you're going to, hey, excuse me. It will explode right there before you even check him. There's nothing you can do against it. It's whatever Hashem wants. Without Hashem, there's nothing you can do. The difference between Sharon and what we say here, that he actually spoke from weakness, and he was trying to present it as a strength. It was totally weakness. The army didn't have an answer. If they had, they would do something about it. I'm not talking about this. I'm talking the opposite, when you can actually retaliate. Big time. This person regret the day he was born. And you leave it to Hashem. And you're still nice to him. Most of the time, it would ease his hate. You see that you're nice to him, after a while, he won't feel comfortable. And he would leave you alone. And this is what it means. Atov v'ametiv la'ra'im v'latovim. Hashem benefits the good and the bad. How? The fact that he gives oxygen to all the mechalelei Shabbat. How can it be? In the Torah it says none of them deserve to live. But Hashem gives them oxygen every Shabbat. Knowing they deserve to die. According to the Torah. I did not write the Torah. Torah says mechalel Shabbat mot yumat. That's why the punishment of mechalel Shabbat in a bed din, in Sanhedrin. And 7 years Hashem gives him enough money and food and oxygen and air to live. Metiv la'ra'im. Later he will serve him the bill, yes. But in the meantime, how great you have to be to feed your enemy 7 years and to help him and to make him succeed and give him money and a house and a wife and children and health. Do you know one person that will be able to do such thing? Would you be able to give donation to your enemy? You know how hard it is? If you did, then you know you've stepped one level higher, for sure. To go hiddenly and push cash in someone's under the door when he speaks against you, and you know he's poor. Or to get him a job. Without telling him, you see, I'm not like you. Without. Oh, you need a job? Here is a job for you. Why would you help me? I do very bad things against you. It's okay. It's Yetzer Hara, it's not you. I forgive you, don't worry. Very high level. Very high level. Be'ezrat Hashem, we finish this session. Next week, we will continue speaking about the pleasure from pride and honor. We will give all kinds of examples from life. We'll speak about the power of the nefesh, of the soul. How do you recognize mental issues? If you think, oh, I don't have to come next week because I'm perfectly mentally healthy, think again. Next week you're going to get the shock of your life, how sick we all are. Okay? So please come ready. Prepare yourself a week for next week, for the 12th section of this series. Thank you very much for coming. Baruch Adonai Leolam. Amen ve'amen.